that Complexity picked up last game. So it's going to be a very, very new draft from Complexity, so I'm excited to see that. And the Slardar picked up here first for DC. And by the way, I don't know if you caught this last game, but 1437, who has just been announced not only, what, an hour ago, 2 hours ago, that he's now the
Bang.
official fifth. He's actually drafting for them now. Was he drafting last
Complexity's
game? Did you manage to
coming
catch
to play.
that?
He did actually, yeah. He was announced as the team captain and the
Oh.
drafter for them. So
Okay.
big news, a whole lot of things to work out, and in what is going to be now their first official match with him, on their roster, even though it still says stand in next to him. It's something to keep in mind that, maybe there's some. I think it's so tough to add somebody to a roster. I mean, you've played professionally. What are your thoughts
10
on that, adding
seconds
somebody to a roster
remaining.
and how it shakes things up?
Well, adding one player to your roster is one thing, but then
Five
adding them
seconds
and then
remaining.
them instantly coming in to take over the team and captain them is another, I think,
Reserve time.
which is a big leap because it changes the way your entire team plays. If you're changing a carry player, I think you can generally change carry player like you change your underwear. It's at least well maybe a pack patches ago you could. A carry
Once a
player now
week, yeah.
is a lot more dynamic and needs to move around a lot more. So
Radiant
maybe it's a little
team
more
pick.
difficult to do that now. But their role is still pretty cut and dry. But as a captain, that changes the entire dynamic of the team. So with him coming in as the new captain and the new drafter, I didn't know this. It basically says I'm going to take all the information I had from my last team and kind of add it to you guys, and we'll see if it works together. And this has all happened very abruptly and very, very
Winter
quickly. So
arrival.
we'll have to see if they can make any kind of
Radiant
big
team
changes
ban.
in here in game two, because I think that the loser is out. Correct me if I'm wrong, right?
That's true, yes. The loser
Okay.
does end up dropping out of this one, and then the winner's going to go on and in a couple of hours here just play against Archon Dota, who have been looking really strong this tournament so far.
10 seconds
Yes, they
remaining.
have. So anyway, they go with the Slardar, and then its
Five
response is
seconds
Bane and Tusk
remaining.
from Complexity. Pretty strong heroes. Both heroes with very, very strong abilities.
Reserve time.
They don't really they very low downtime for their ult or for all their
Complexity's turn
spells.
to
The
ban.
ultimate is 100-second cooldown for Fiend's Grip, which actually isn't really that long if you think about it. I think that's the same cooldown as the Doom, but I could be wrong on that. And then Wyvern strong too, so pretty strong on both sides, but very different from the last game.
Yeah, certainly. And I
Ten
think that
seconds
Bane,
remaining.
when we think about the path that this hero has taken over the past couple of
Five
weeks, he
seconds
became a
remaining.
marquee member of the early shutting down the mid laner for the enemy side.
Reserve
He runs on
time.
in there, even if you just end up taking on a Brain Sap at level ones. I mean, back in the day, I feel like we ended up seeing Enfeeble taken and messing with the enemy mid laner. But I think here, the Brain Sap, you're able to trade so efficiently with whoever's in there. Winter Wyvern, another hero. So I think that the dynamic of this game is going to change a lot from last time. I don't expect to see another Huskar at Digital Chaos, especially with the Dazzle already banned out by them. And I think that it didn't really look that scary for them, so Complexity never felt like they needed to ban it out either. So
Radiant
I
team
kind of
ban.
like this draft so far for Digital Chaos. It feels like also they might be going into a little bit of one of those minus armor type of strategies. That's always something that's relevant with Slardar. And possibly, if they end up finding the space for it, I think
Ten
a Windranger
seconds
could be a pretty
remaining.
good next pickup for them if they wanted to try and secure that early,
Five
strong
seconds
laning
remaining.
dominance.
Yeah, Windranger would be very nice. Tusk is just such a good
Reserve
hero.
time.
I'm thinking about, well, if they get shackled, Tusk can just snowball, the hero
That's a
can
good
get
point.
shackled. But I mean, he's going to be doing that against anyone that has any kind of initiation or any kind of stun. It's just a very, very good hero for that reason. PL banned out here
Complexity's
from
turn to
DC, as
ban.
well as the Dazzle. Dazzle Bane's kind of a weird combination of heroes. I'm not sure if they would go for that. We don't even know for sure if this is going to be a Tusk offlane or a
Right.
Tusk 4. But as you mentioned with Bane,
Ten
most likely
seconds
harassing the
remaining.
mid, it does make more sense to have him as the 4, but nothing's set in stone.
Five
Quat banned out
seconds
here from
remaining.
Complexity. Maybe they just banned that out because they feel that DC's comfortable with Quap and they pick it a
Reserve
lot.
time.
Again, as you alluded to earlier, we don't know for sure what they're seeing in each other's scrims. Maybe they like to pick Quap a lot in their scrims too. So anyway, one final ban out coming from Complexity. They're actually taking some reserve time thinking about this. So really, really want to find the right hero.
Yeah, definitely. You talked a little bit ago as well about Tusk, and You know, I keep on alluding back to the Frankfurt Major because that was such a strong showing that we saw from that hero. I think that he was picked and banned, picked or banned in every single game. And I feel like we're moving more and more into a situation where teams are picking heroes that are dynamic and capable of being played in multiple positions, first of all, because the draft is so much more important than I feel like it's almost ever been. And on top of that, you need to be able to have a hero that can simultaneously, you know, be defensive with the Snowball there in Tusk or Bane with his Nightmare, and also have the ability to dole out a lot of damage and create that control. TA is going to be taken out this time. Another one of those mid laners they wanted trying to take over that lane. And with Alina pick, there aren't a whole lot left that are going to be incredibly strong here.
Yeah, I was just thinking Lina, Windrunner, but because they have the Wyvern, it makes so much sense to pick up the Lina. Obviously, a huge counter to the Cold Embrace. If anything, the Cold Embrace helps set up the Lina LSA in certain situations. So that's a pretty standard pickup here in this position for complexity. As you mentioned, I wouldn't be surprised at all still to see the Windrunner picked up. I mean, look at all the mid laners that are banned out or taken. There's Lina taken out of the pool. No TA, no Quap, no SF. The next best thing here really is the Windrunner. Unless you also want to go for a Viper yourself in some kind of five-man lineup. But again, the reason why Viper was so good last game is because you had the mobility of the Wisp to move him around. That is the number one weakness of Viper in general, is that the hero is very strong, you want to fight, but most teams won't fight you. As simple as that. But if you can force them to fight you with a Relocate or some other kind of way to get him into the fray, then you can utilize that. But they go with a Tiny here, which is, I think, totally fine.
You know, I was actually, honestly, I was about to say that we saw a couple of Tiny plays yesterday where they were using the Tiny as the initiation for the Slaughter before he gets his Blink Dagger, and as a way to apply a good bit more pressure. I mean, honestly, it just looks silly when you see it in the game, but it's incredibly powerful. That's the problem that you end up having with Slardar, is being able to find that initiation without leaving yourself open with the extra damage you take from Sprint. So I think that if you have that combination there together, you have a lineup that can potentially find pickoffs at the early stages of this game. We've been seeing Tiny get played sometimes in the support role, particularly on the Radiant side. Do you think that's something that we could see this game, and do you feel like that's a strategy that works and is pretty good?
I think it can work. I don't think that DC are going to do it, though.
Okay.
It is a little bit cheeky, but I feel like if they did it, Complexity does have the heroes to really, really punish that. I mean, they have Complexity has three heroes with tons of strong abilities, tons of nuke damage, good stun, good control, all together. Like, they can fight very early on. Now they add to that with picking up a Gyrocopter, which I think is very, very understandable. This is probably Zizzy's most comfortable hero. And seeing how he is standing in for Chessie for whatever reason, I don't know. It makes a lot of sense for them to pick that up. Razor now here picked up for Digital Chaos. I love Razor. I think he's a really, really good hero.
Yeah.
It's very, very good against the Bane. All four of Bane's spells are single target, which means if he wanted to cast any of those, he's going to get purged from the Unstable Current of Razor. So Razor's thought of as a really good hero against two things. One, like strength heroes that are very slow that you can suck their damage out, like Bristleback, for example, who also has a single target nuke. And it's also good against single target nukes, like Bane. Rubick is a really good hero that it's good against. So yeah, I think Razor's fine here. I'm not sold on the Tiny, though, actually, now that I think about it, but we'll see what rounds up their lineup as their fifth support hero. The Lich was banned out from Complexity. Remaining.
Yeah, Lich taken away, and also that Bounty Hunter, last but not least, not wanting to be able to give them that extra gold infusion they sometimes see. There we go, Undyne. God, this is, I was sort of cringing a little bit with the Razor pick just because I hate playing against this hero, and I feel like he's always frustrating to go against. But if you have this much aggression early, particularly that Rocket Barrage, being able to get up in Razor's face, maybe you're able to burst him before he steals too much damage, but it's kind of a fine line to tread, because obviously Lina there as well, you've got a lot of burst damage to take Razor down, but that also leaves you open to being up close to this hero who sort of exceeds at being able to get in early engagements by stealing other people's damage. 5 seconds remaining.
I really like this pickup. I think it's going to work well for their lineup. Tusk and Undying is very strong. Digital Chaos, they need to find some kind of support that can maneuver around this lane of Tusk and Undying. Wyvern can't really. He's pretty slow, I think. Yeah, he does have the Arctic Burn, but... and also, Razor, I think Razor's going to go mid, right? I don't imagine...
Yeah.
I mean, I guess Tiny could go mid against the Lina, but I feel like Lina would just punish him. You also have to anticipate that Bane probably will be helping out if Wyvern does, or might maybe helps him out even if Wyvern doesn't, and then Lina gets off to a really good start. I think it has to be Razor mid, so Tiny, Winter, Wyvern,
Wind Ranger at your
or
service.
It is going to be a support Tiny. Maybe you nailed it.
Interesting. That's one of the... Okay, I'm not going to go there. Anyways, yes, so we do end up seeing the support Tiny.
You nailed it. I was wrong. Trav was wrong.
Well, and Lyrical was left, or whatever it is. All right, so we're going to have Wind Ranger picked up here. It's a nice
I was
combo.
Left, that's right. You were right, I was left.
Okay, that's what it is. Wind Ranger is pretty strong there with the Slardar as well. It's going to be that Aoi 2000 Tiny that we're going to end up seeing this time around, as we've talked about. And I think this is somewhat of an interesting way to deal with it, because we always talk about the early aggression that comes out from the Tuscan Undying, and if you just sort of counter that with a ton of burst damage, maybe then you're going to be able to take on out of the whole course of this that early aggression, stymie it a little bit by being able to take out the Undying or the Tusk. Of course, the problem they end up running into is that if you're not able to kill them very quickly, it could be a very scary situation for them.
Yeah, and when I think of Radiant support Tiny, which is why you asked, I instantly think of Secret doing the mid lane pull, and I think it just got pinged up by, I'm not sure if it was brown or orange, but either way, that is in the back of their heads. The first person I saw do that, though, was a long time ago. I saw Fnatic do it. I think it was Hani, way back when he was playing for them, and I saw him do it. It was the first time. They were playing against EG, and it was in the D2 Well Season 4, I believe. And I saw them do that, and it was so devastating because they had no idea. But now with it kind of in the heads of people and heads of players, oh, we might see an engagement here.
Yeah, Aoi does have Toss skilled up level 1. They haven't taken a skill yet on Bane, not wanting to commit to that Nightmare as of yet, but everybody's down here. This is going to leave a free rune up in the top lane for the Wind Ranger, and potentially might run into a few problems. It does look like Limp is going to just back on out, not wanting to take too much aggression as of yet. But actually, they do end up spotting out Handskin over here, so they're going to know he's in the area. This might be a quick kill if he's not careful. He is running around the other side. We do also have the Slardar moving in. He's going to run into the creep wave if he's not careful, hiding in the trees. They should know about this, though, right?
I think they saw them. Now they're looking at... Bulba's going to be extremely late to his lane, by the way.
Oh, my God.
Like, he is not even close to that lane. And Hanskin struts on out of there. Really nicely played by him. He does run at 315 movement speed, so he is much faster than these heroes. 300 only for the Slardar. Only 285 for the Tiny. And despite the fact that he placed two wards here, neither of them blocked either of these camps.
Oh, wow.
So that really, really sucks. So despite him, you know, kind of getting out of jail free there... he still buys sentries, but it doesn't really matter. He's actually going to bring the salve to Yawar because he's still scared of the Bane. They're not quite sure where he is. But Yawar runs back, maybe gives up a free CS or two for Limp. And we'll see if this bad positioning now for Bulba, because he got up to the lane late, is going to hurt him. As Handskin runs around, hasn't skilled up anything yet, but he is going to put him some damage. The stun coming out, it does hit Zizzy.
Ooh, yeah, and, he's going to be able to walk away from that one. Nightmare down. They actually have a chance now with the Rocket Barrage as well as the Body Box. Bulba doesn't have that phase movement, but the one creep is going to draw away enough aggro that not quite going to be able to find that kill. And with a Nightmare scaled, no chance for a Brain Sap. What a weird start to this game again. Like, the last game I felt like was very strange. This one I feel like is also very strange. They are going to be able to deny out a good amount of experience here. And it doesn't actually block either of the camps for Aoi, so they're going to continue to connect this pull here.
He missed the big creep, though, with a toss. He mistimed it, unfortunately. So he doesn't get the gold for the big bird, whatever it's called.
Wow,
but he will connect it, nonetheless. Yeah, it's very strange that, like, it feels like this ward was placed deliberately in this spot. So it's like, oh, wow, he's gone to practice mode, and he knows exactly where to place it. But it doesn't. So kind of a missed opportunity right there. You would think that if you're going to be warding something very crucial like this, that you would know that it blocks, but... Well, you'll know for next time.
Absolutely. Well, Z-Freak is going to come on in here. Does get hit by an avalanche. That's going to be a nice last hit there for Aoi, as he ends up being able to take him on out. The haste rune soon to expire on the Undying, but they do have the fight on over here. Swindle needs to be careful. He is going to be able to salve on up and just walk away from that one. But now we get in a situation where 1437 and TC are in the area, and it's a lot of nuke damage that comes out from Razors at the early levels, especially if he's able to steal a decent amount of damage with that static link.
Yep, and despite the pull, in mid lane, Yuar seems to be a little bit behind the Lina, just slightly. What I basically mean is that Limp has not been hindered by this pulling as of yet. Now, he does get a secondary pull here for Aoi, or that is for Aoi, and this one might actually hurt, as he's got some really nice creeps to work with. A good 87 gold there. See if he can pull it to the next camp as well. Maybe he doesn't. He's kind of walking around. Doesn't. Oh, there he goes. Okay. Gets the toss. Unfortunately, misses that one as well. So missing a little bit of gold, but still nonetheless getting the pull.
Bottom lane. We have an initiation for the 7. Oh, just barely going to get out with that cold embrace. It's going to keep him alive at least for a second. They haven't taken up Tombstone, and it did end up getting taken out, but they do finally find that kill, and now TC dropping low as well. It looked like they were going to be fine for a second, and just sticking around a little bit too long. Swindles is going to be able to stay alive through this as well with the Tango regeneration. And now the jump forward. Limp is going to end up getting caught here. Shackle doesn't land, but the Avalanche and the Crush will. Light Strike Array is going to connect on to Yuar, but not going to be able to be there in time. So quick trades going out across the map as we do end up seeing the Razor as well as the Winter Wyvern dying, but four Limp in the mid lane on that Lina.
It seems that indecision is kind of plaguing DC from time to time. You saw there at the end, like, TC was running away, but then he kind of decided that he wanted to then kill the Tombstone, so he ran backwards to kill the Tombstone, and then that was his demise. So interesting play there, but nonetheless a very, very good two kills there from Complexity. And not only are they getting kills in that lane, but they're kind of stifling TC's farm as well. He's only got 11 CS compared to the 24 free farming Gyro up top. So they are succeeding in their efforts here in the bottom lane is Complexity.
Well, and see, the other thing is that, like, you end up rotating on in the Slardar to be able to find that kill with the Tiny, but it's a lot to commit to make that happen. And now also with the stacking on up here, it does look like Swindles is going to be able to slightly interrupt this pull. The creeps are going to go the long way around, but now Limp's going to be able to get all of the CS and simultaneously take away one of the Radiant's medium camps. So farming pretty efficiently, at least at this point in time. And you mentioned he hasn't really been shut down too hard, 22-0 versus the 29-2 of the Windranger. So Windranger obviously ahead, but not by a terribly significant amount.
Well, and I think most of the discrepancy of CS there is, comes from the gank that happened, if not so much the pulling. Ooh, nice power shot there, taking him to half HP. But the, yeah, the pulls have been annoying, but Limp has been holding his own despite that. It was really the gank.
Bottom lane, Z-Freak is static linked up. They have the Tombstone drop, but they do have the rotational in. Aoi, Avatoss combo. There's going to be the Snowball to keep him alive a little bit longer. Zombies are starting to pile up. Handskins has rotated on in as well, and that's going to be TC going down. The Tombstone left alive for so long, and now Aoi is spread out a little bit. The creeps are blocking off his path. Handskin just continuing to right-click him down. They do have another decay. Soul Rip in 8 seconds. Doesn't look like they're going to be able to find this kill, though. Maybe with the brain sap, snowball forward, they're going to be able to take him out. That's a double kill now for Swindles, as this bottom lane has really not been going DC's way at all.
And they knew what they were getting into somewhat. I mean, they didn't see the Undying until the very end, but they knew that there was going to be a Tusk. And whenever you see a Tusk, you can anticipate some kind of dueling, because almost any hero just complements the skill set of Tusk. Mm-hmm. And also, what I think is kind of interesting is Tusk is very, very good against the Razor. He can snowball, not get static linked. What is it called? Static charge? Unstable Currented. All right, I wasn't even close. But he can snowball, he doesn't even get purged. He can also cast a charge, which doesn't target, so he doesn't get purged. He's very good in that sense against the Razor.
Yeah. Well, the other thing to keep in mind is that it was an Undying's sixth pick, and considering how popular Radiant's that dual lane has been throughout the past, I want to say, month or so of Dota 2 that we've been seeing, it felt a little bit strange for it to be able to get that pick that late in the draft.
Right.
Regardless, we're in this situation now. Winter Wyvern has hit level 3, Razor close to 6, and we'll be able to somewhat more efficiently deal with Z-Freak and Swindles down here, but it's by no means an easy lane, because, I mean, Swindles is getting close to his 6, and once you have Walrus Punch down, while you won't be able to chase as efficiently, you still do have the ability to snowball forward after you Walrus Punch in. So
exactly.
Regardless, it's still a really good lane, I feel like, for Complexity.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that, too. Like, even if you're Purge, you just snowball and just ignore that fact. So it's almost like Tusk is a counter to the Razor, despite him being a melee hero. And as you mentioned, yes, Undying was picked at the end, but Undying is also quite good against Razor too, because yes, you have the Soul Rip, but your main ability is that non-single target decay, and then also, of course, the Tombstone, which he didn't get level 3, by the way. went for an extra point into the Soul Rip, so he wants to have a lower cooldown, maybe the extra damage and heal. Find them just a little bit curious, but I think it's totally fine. I mean, they're still getting kills, and they're still ahead, and they're still keeping the CS of this Razor down.
Yeah, definitely, and doing a great job of it. You take a look at net worth right now, Razor is fifth behind the Tusk, and currently Gyrocopter has pretty much been getting everything that he wants in lane, including a whole bunch of stacks off here in the jungle. We do have one medium Dyer's camp that it looks like Lina is actually going to be taking in a second. Hard camp stacked up three times as well. And this is going to give you a lot of ability to scale into this late game. We'll see if Zizzy ends up wanting to go on over into the Ancients to stack them up with the Helm of the Dominator creep at a later state, but at least at this point in time, I feel like Complexity are in a very strong position. Almost 3,000, well, 2,500 gold up. Experience-wise, 1,500. What do you think they need to do to get back into this lane? Is it a matter of trying to, for DC that is. Oh gosh, never mind. Rotation on in. It looks like Aoi is going to go down, I believe. Avalanche, it was a nice toss back. Does he stay alive through that? Oh, Nightmare. They are going to be able to trade off the Nightmare, and it looks like he is going to survive. That was close.
I think he would have died, but unfortunately Bane missed an attack uphill, which would have been the death, I think, of Aoi, seeing as he is, or he was at like 38 HP, so very, very close there. Nice play there from Yawari by saving his buddy with the swap of the Nightmare. To answer your question, though, I think it really honestly needs to be a blink on the Slardar, but he is nowhere close to one. There's really no, like, we got this item, let's go fight, except for the blink on DC. I'm not seeing anything else. Like, maybe the Windranger Axe, but he's pretty far away from that. Razor, he doesn't really have a single item that's like, let's go fight. He kind of gets build-up items, like, I got my treads, now I got my drums, now I got my point booster, and then finally I got my Axe. Yeah. Or I see a lot of players go for the S and Y rush for Razor. But that's not really like, I got my item, let's go fight kind of thing. Unless you go for the mech, which I haven't seen on Razor for a long time.
Definitely. Play him a bit more like that Viper. I will mention that I think that Swindles ended up getting the Illusion Rune and then leaving one of the Illusions down in the bot lane chasing after the Undying to hide the fact that he was ganking the mid lane. So pretty cool move there to make that happen. Unfortunately, didn't end up paying off for them. We do have a 3-man smoke into the top lane to try and find out Zizzy on this Gyrocopter. The rest of his team do have a decent amount of TPs and can get up here. Lina, the only hero that's not really in the area, and they do end up finding him out. Zizzy is going to end up falling here. Oh god, the cooldown is going to be pretty big, but I think they can make it out before this all comes about. That is going to be a kill on Aoi 2000 as Tiny crumbles to the brain sap, but Handskin, the only hero to rotate, everybody else staying put.
It was good for DC for the fact that they got a better trade, like the support for a core, but really well played, honestly, by Zizzy, like casting that spell as soon as he could. It's very important that, as Fogged always said, I remember this, that especially playing support, if you know you're going to die, it's imperative that you get your spells off. I didn't think he was going to get anything off, but he actually managed to get the cooldown off, so well played by Zizzy.
Absolutely. It is also going to give, at least at this point, DC the ability to get level 6 up on the Slardar. Actually, level 7 now, excuse me. So while he doesn't have a blink, he is still pretty strong if he's able to get into range. They're going to jump forward, trying to catch onto Handskin. They do have the Winter's Curse if they want to commit that. DC is off here as well, but it feels like they're so deep at this point in time. Any TP rotations can be pretty big. It looks like, at least at this point in time, they're going to content themselves with taking the Tier 1 down in the bottom lane, not wanting to fight as of yet. Swindles does end up tossing on out a Snowball as well as the Ice Shards onto the Windranger, but with the Windrun, no real way for them to get any type of return kill. Fight recap at the end of the kill on the Bane, that's going to be a 500 gold swing, but also a tier 1 tower, and they can potentially get into position to defend this top. It's still very full on HP.
They do have a glyph. They would need to start TPing a lot of people up there, and there's no TP available in the Gyro, though. It's on cooldown. And yeah, I think they're just going to sack it at this point.
Instead, going to call for maybe the mid tower?
Top tower. I'm surprised. I thought they had a glyph up, though. They didn't even use it. Unless my user interface is wrong. So that's kind of a little mishap. Radiant's
middle tower. It does look like they're going to at least be able to take on out this tier 1 in the mid lane. It does look like DC are trying to come into position to defend against this. 1437, not quite level 6 yet. They do end up tossing out the Avalanche as well as the Splinter Blast. That's so much damage on top of Zizzy.
Landed every spell, but they are going to take this mid tower, so obviously fine for Complexity. Don't imagine they're going to be giving up their tier 2 top, though, so they are going to just back up and farm and kind of slow down the game just a little bit.
And after those couple of towers taken, Complexity take a 3,000 gold lead. Experience about 2k. Big items that are coming up on these heroes. Windranger, as we mentioned, still a ways away from picking on up that Aghanim Scepter, but 1,800 or so can come pretty quickly for a core. Tusk hasn't really picked up or invested in another item as of yet. I think probably for me, the Yule Scepter on Lina is going to be a fairly large item just to be able to disengage from fights or find pickoffs around the map.
Yule's is always good on Lina, but you do have to be a little bit careful this game because there's a lot of like follow-up initiation. Speaking of, if he goes on to Bulba right now, I feel like this could be bad for him. As he's
Lightsicker, Laguna Blade.
I feel like 1437 could have helped him there.
Well, just going to back on out at this point in time. Not going to help out his buddy. 600 gold swing. I guess he does have Winter's Curse, but didn't have enough mana at that point.
I think he just used a Splinter Blast, though. That was a little bit strange. I thought Limp was going to see him and be like, oh, crap, he's got a buddy, and then run away. But all right. But they also did bait out the TP from Yawar, so making them move. That was actually a really big kill from Complexity.
Yeah, huge. Slardar going down, it you know slows on down that blink timing as well. He was trying to get it as quickly as possible. I will say in terms of DC's lineup, they have a lineup that can come back. You know, you look at the combos that they've got as we do end up seeing Windranger just barely get out of range of those shards. But you think about Splinter Blast, they're able to constantly keep creep waves pushed out. Maxed out level is going to one-shot range creeps. Two shots on the 7-second cooldown is going to mean that the whole creep wave is dead. Winter's Curse is always going to be relevant and scales well against the lineups that you've gotten. Also, I mean, being able to have that Tiny in a support, while he doesn't have very much farm, he still has the insane burst combo, which is always relevant, even in the late stages of the game. So I feel like they have the tools to make it happen. It's just going to come down to a matter of execution.
Yeah, the thing I'm worried most about for DC is that they don't really have a clear-cut way to deal with this Tombstone if it's placed correctly. I know Z-Freak plays this hero a lot, too, so he's really it's come down to like an art, really, with where he places it. He just knows the exact placement that he needs, especially when they're pushing. But if you look at their lineup, they got two melee heroes, which can't really take care of the tomb. One of their ranged heroes is the Wyvern, who can't take care of it. I guess he can maybe take care of it with an Arctic Burn, but you don't really want to use an Arctic Burn to take care of a tomb. Then you got the Windranger, which is probably your best bet with the Windrun. And Razor, he doesn't really want to get in there to take out the tomb unless it's really out of position. So that's the only thing the biggest thing I should say that I fear for DC's lineup is having to deal with this Tombstone.
Well, unfortunately, it doesn't look like they're going to be able to realize that Roshan is going down. He is about to fall, or maybe they're just comfortable trading the Tier 1 for the Rosh at that point, seeing as they didn't think they could contest it. In either case, they trade a Tier 1 tower for Roshan, and a bit of damage up on the top lane as well, as TC is going to be able to right-click away this tower and possibly get it. They do have the glyph up, as long as this isn't that weird bug that was going on earlier or something. They do end up using the glyph now, and with the rest of Complexity moving in, they need to get out of here before something starts getting a little bit too crazy. They're going to be able to get the deny, though.
They do get the deny. So, I mean, it's still a tower dead, though. I think that's actually fine for DC. They made all five heroes rotate, unless TC gets caught out. Nope, he's not going to. They made all five heroes rotate. They got a tower, so a little bit of map control going their way. They're farming on their Slardar, who desperately needs that Blink Dagger, and he's actually pretty close. So, yeah, you gave up Rosh, but I think you have to in that kind of situation.
Well, and I was wondering if they just didn't know that it was going on, but given the vision and how it was looking, I would be very surprised if DC didn't realize that Roshan was being taken. So probably a good choice on them, and they're able to, you know, extend this game a little bit longer. Complexity taking advantage by being able to take an objective, but it's still not an insurmountable lead at this point in time. I mean, you do have the Yasha being built up by the Razor now, probably going to try and build into the Sanj afterwards and give him a lot more ability to fight in these engagements, that extra HP. Slaughter has the Blink, as you mentioned, and all the pieces are maybe going to start to come together. Level 7 on the Winter Wyvern, Splinter Blast is a big old nuke, and looks like they're going to try and bait TC for a little bit here.
Radiant's top tower.
Oh god, this could be a little bit scary. This might be a bad initiation.
I think this is bad for DC. Although Limp might get caught out, there's actually a sleep onto the wrong target there, but here comes a grip on the Bulba.
TC is going to end up falling down there in the side as well. It looks like 1437 is going to go down. Oh god, Yawar as well. He has the missile on top of him. They are still chasing the Tiny off in the river, so 3-on-2 over there on that side, and that is going to be the Windranger going down, possibly somehow staying alive throughout all of this. Also, Tiny chasing away over there. He's nightmared up. leaving him alone at least for the time being. There's the Walrus Punch, followed in after the Snowball, and a full man team wipe as only Limp ended up going down for the side of Complexity.
And he would have lived if the sleep came up, or if the nightmare came up onto him. What happened was he got tossed up, and since Tiny was sitting right next to him, it can be kind of awkward trying to target correctly. And unfortunately, the Bane slept Tiny instead of the... if he slept the Lina, that Lina wouldn't have taken like any damage, and they would have 5-0'd them. Regardless, though, ooh, nice stun initiation there for Bulba with a really nice Splinter Blast.
Swindlewell is going to be able to stay alive a little bit longer. The Snowball keeping him alive. The Calldown isn't going to hit on anybody except for Aoi 2000. Swindles might go down here as the Aegis has already been popped one time. A couple more right clicks is all it's going to take, but they're not going to be going for it. TC goes out with the Plasma Field. That's going to be able to secure the kill. Now Zizzy ran away, already amped damaged up, looking for their second point of initiation. The Shackle is going to land as they end up tossing Bulba in on top of Zizzy. And that's just the power of that combo. It doesn't even need a Blink Dagger at that point in time. Able to TP out at the last second. And DC pick up a few kills at the end, being able to turn that one back around a little bit more into their favor.
And their kills are worth a lot more. If you look at the recent kills, the ones that Complexity were getting onto the Tiny and Windranger were 328 and 362 respectively, but the kills that DC just got were like 521 on the Tusk, also in the Spree, and then 400 for the Gyro. So their net worth is higher. When they get these kills, it means more. So you can't be complacent if you're Complexity, even though you're ahead. Because you do give up more gold. And as you mentioned, I mean, DC's lineup, I think they're much more prone to go late game against Complexity with this lineup than the last one. So you got to be careful.
Absolutely. Stacks are coming on out for the Ancients on the Dire side, and hopefully Gyrocopter is going to be able to take those relatively soon. The thing that's worth noting also is, at this point in time, DC actually have the advantage in terms of towers. They've been able to lose all of their Tier 1 towers on DC, but they've taken two Tier 1s and a Tier 2. And that top lane has really been pressured somewhat significantly by that Roshan take early on Complexity side, and they weren't able to break through on the other one. Vision-wise, I think the game is much more into the favor of Complexity. They have pretty much complete vision down here on the on the south side of the map. Actually, this one might end up getting dewarded. But regardless, they are looking for a kill onto Zizzy here in the top lane. Aoi is in the area with the Windranger, thinking about going for it, but without anybody else on the map because of that lack of vision, they're not going to be going for this one, at least at this time.
Oh, he's going to walk down now, but he's walking right in front of our creep wave. Just going to kind of cut it, hit it a couple times, and then be on his way. If they can somehow get a Blink Dagger up on this Tiny, could be a new form of aggression here onto Complexity that they don't have. They obviously don't have a Blink on the Windranger. Their only initiation is really the Winter's Curse and the Slardar stun right now, which is great, don't get me wrong. But they might need a little bit more if they want to start taking the lead here in this game. Yep,
definitely. Well, 5,000 net worth lead currently into the favor of Complexity, as well as an experience, about 5,500. We're taking
big stack being taken
again
right now by Complexity.
Yeah, that's the one that you're talking about. And Tombstone dropped as well to secure that. Gives a little bit more of that those levels to Z-Freak. Now he has level 11, 2 points in that Flesh Golem. Also worth noting that the Windranger just picked up the Aghanim Scepter now, so can start changing targets a little bit more frequently with the Focus Fire. And having that on top of the Slardar is super relevant. I mean, you're going to be able to burst on through this Gyrocopter, and they don't have the same type of defensive support that they had in the last game with that Io, or even having something like the Dazzle, which means you can potentially burst on through this hero if you're able to have a couple of seconds just to have the focus on him. And I think that that's the point where probably Winter's Curse is going to be the biggest spell for DC, and 1437's play here, they're going to need him to come up big for them to win, I think, the next engagement, given the item advantage on Complexity side.
Yeah, Winter's Curse is such a great ability, and he's actually got some decent farm on him, too. Glimmerclave, here comes an aggressive smoke. Four man, TC was not smoked, though, kind of awkward. So if they did run into any wards, TC would get spotted. Luckily for their sake, there are no wards, unless TC walks backwards, but it's just going to be a four man. They know Limp is here. He does have a Lothar's up in 1 second. If he suspects something's up, he can run away.
Oh, they're going to be able to find this initiation, I think. The other thing is they have to have Winter's Curse and Handskin. They're going to end up starting an attack here with the Lina. They get the vision on Limp. He's going to end up falling. Did they actually end up killing him there with the Nightmare revealing him?
No, I think he was dead. Okay. I think they already got the...
Oh, they got the sentry down, of course. I'm dumb. All right,
well,
cool.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So they would have, I mean, it was a nice attempt from him, but couldn't, I thought that actually he was going to kill himself by nightmaring because I thought he would reveal his position and then they would rush toward him, but they wanted to secure the kill on Lina.
Yeah,
And that's the big one.
Oh, TC now is caught out off to the sides. Beautiful shards blocking him off on both sides. And with three heroes in there, that's going to be a really quick kill. Gyrocopter ends up finishing that one off. And
oh, nice shards on the Bulba
side.
Too.
Bulba as well. Oh my goodness. This Tusk has been playing very, very well. This is actually, it's worth noting, this is Swindle's only third game on Tusk. We saw his second game ever, at least in professional matches, just the other day. And now being able to really make good use of this hero, does have Guardian Greaves on up, and they're starting to pressure this on out. Oh, there's the Windranger getting caught out yet again. Walrus Punch follow up afterwards as Bulba is nightmared. Do have the Fiend's Grip up if they want to commit it, and they are for Bulba. That's going to be the call, though. They end up shackling too. Z-Freak hasn't dropped on down the Tombstone as of yet. The homing missile is going to connect, not enough to be able to kill him off. Avalanche just going to be saying, get on out of my base. And Complexity are going to walk away from that one. But picking off TC, as well as being able to apply all that pressure, I guess they committed Fiend's Grip and weren't able to get a kill, though.
Really nice shackle there from Yor. You could say a bit of a blunder there from Z-Freak by running forward and providing him the opportunity to shackle shot. If he didn't run forward, Yor would have had to run a lot further down, or I should say a lot further up, to get that shackle shot to hit it to the next tree. But because Z-Freak was running forward, it gave him a lot more of a safe position to actually get a shackle and a faster way to do so. So nice save there from Yor. If he didn't get that, that was for sure a death on the Slardar.
The other thing there is with that jump onto Bulba on the Slardar up here in the top lane, they did end up revealing the ward. It was about to expire, but they still get the 50 gold as well as experience from it, as we did end up seeing 1437 go over to deward it. Blink Dagger up on the Tiny. You talked about that extra form of initiation, the other jump that you might possibly have. Zizzy is going to use the cooldown now on top of Bulba, interrupting his ability to jump on top of him and blink. And he just ends up TPing away. Roshan back up again. Z-Freak is going to end up dropping the Tombstone for the ability to soak up some more damage onto these Ancients. But I guess that's kind of a weird one. I guess they're going to come on in and take Roshan.
Yeah, I don't know about that. But anyway, it's going to be going down. The great thing about Tiny with Blink, especially as a support, is that it's similar to the idea if you have a Pudge on your team and someone is pushing into you. It's always that extra X factor that you have to be worried about, like, we can lose this fight if one of my heroes gets, you know, separated from the rest of my team instantly.
Yeah.
Obviously, the hook is much better because the toss, you have to blink in into harm's way to get off the toss, and it's not even 100% that you get it. But it's still the idea is still there that you can separate someone from the rest of their team.
The most ghetto of Bat Riders is the
Tiny. Yeah, exactly.
All right, 1437 does kind of reveal his positioning here. The shards are going to catch him out as well. He needs to run away. Glimmer Cape on up. They're going to be able to have vision. Trying to TP away. He actually gets out. Hanskin tried to go for the Nightmare. Wasn't able to catch him. And now pressure applied up top. And we talked about the fact that there's no Tier 2 tower up here. They're going to be able to pressure this a lot longer than Complexity are, because they're going to be able to start applying that pressure. We also do have the Glyph up on DC. So nice little positioning here. Limp is in biz up. He can toss on out that Light Strike Ray if he wants. He's going to end up connecting onto the Windranger. Toss it on forward. Laguna Blade there as well. That's the snowball forward. No, Fiend's Grip going to be able to connect as well, but that ends up getting interrupted. Undying takes on out the Windranger for the turnaround. Oh, Guardian Greaves is up. Bulba's going to end up going down. Three heroes soon to fall for DC. Oh, man.
Really ambitious to say they're that long from the members of DC. I think what they're thinking was, oh, Complexity has an Aegis. They want to go push high ground. They want to go force the issue. And as a team with the Aegis, you do. Like, you want to go push high ground, especially in the position that they're in. But you also, when you're ahead, you don't want to trade ever. That's the general rule. When you're ahead, you want to give as little to the enemy team as possible. And so that's exactly... Complexity made the right call. They're like, yeah, we can go push, but we need to address this issue. We need to not give them an inch. And they made a really, really nice play out of it.
1437 gets the other side of the shards, but Swindles does as well, and now that's going to end up being another quick kill there. Oh my goodness, they are really running a train right now. Swindles with the haste rune also, that's got so much initiation potential. They're pushing on up onto high ground. Zizzy is up top. He's going to just be able to dodge away from every little thing that comes his direction. Windranger now actually separated and does have a lot of damage coming out from that Tombstone. The Soul Rip to keep it alive a little bit longer, and it looks like at this point, at least for a second, Complexity's going to back. Bulba jumped forward on the Slardar. He's going to end up going going down. Glimmer Caper not 1437. Winter's Curse on up. Anskin is right clicking Zizzy, but I think that he still stays alive throughout all of that, looking for their last little opportunity here to catch on to him. Nice ice shards. Tusk ends up taking down the Winter Wyvern. Fight recap. This is a 3,000 gold swing on top of Rax's. They have the ability to move on down towards the bottom lane afterwards if they want, with three dead on DC. There are no buybacks at this point in time, except for on the Razor, who looks to maybe possibly need to use it in a second or two. Oh, nice Shackle going to connect there, but there's going to be the Fiend's Grip on top of the Wind Raider. She's going to go down. Swindles is on a killing spree, blocks off TC yet again. Oh, man, Trouf. This is a very, very good and well-executed game so far by Complexity.
Complexity looking pretty damn good this game. Swindle on the Tusk has really kind of been the MVP this game, I'd say. Especially if even just little things. If you saw when they were gripping one hero, I believe it was the Slardar, I can't remember. But instead of just snowballing him, he snowballs to still stun him after the grip and go for an additional target. So getting the most out of all of his spells rather than just taking the easy way out. And with a skill set like Tusk has, it's very effective. Just constantly keep adding the aggression in the midst of a team fight. This is why this hero is so good. All of his spells are low cooldown. He can constantly keep reinitiating, saving his teammates, running away, reinitiating with a Walrus Punch. It's only 12 second cooldown at level 3. I know he hasn't got there thus far, but that's just to put things into perspective. He's got 18 second cooldown Snowball. He's got 10 second cooldown Ice Shards. His Frozen Sigil lasts for 30 seconds. It's just a very, very good skill set. There's a reason why this hero is picked up all the time.
Well, and it gives you such a... Like, it's not necessarily that Tusk is always going to outplay your opponents, but it gives you the opportunity to pretty much always outplay your opponents. So if you do end up being able to, feel comfortable on this hero, you're just in such a great spot. Worth noting also, Zizzy still has the Aegis, has not dropped it yet. You talked about how comfortable he is on this hero. Butterfly now picked up on top of the Helm of the Dominator, Sanjin Yasha, and this tower is just going to melt away. He does have the Centaur Conqueror here as well, just in case there is a chance for some type of initiation on top of him. He can micro this hero and then end up using that War Stomp. So in such a great space right now. 1437 wanting to use this Winter's Curse, but now you're just hitting it on Zizzy. Nobody else is in the area. Nice dual scepter up on top of Aoi as well, able to get off the toss. Limp is going to finally fall. There's static linking up on top of Zizzy, but there's the Fiend's Grip keeping him aside at this point in time. 1437 dropping low as well from the Rocket Raj. He might end up finally popping. Aegis is going to maybe go down. Is he still alive? How much armor does this guy have? TC is trying to break through that tombstone, but just gets punched in the dome by the Tusk. Everybody is falling at this point in time, and only Limp is down. GG ends up getting called. Oh man, Complexity, too strong.
It's two really convincing performances from Complexity, just very, very much taking a handle over this series. I thought that there was going to be a glimmer of hope because TC was like sucking so much damage. He had like the full amount of damage, but all of his damage was being applied to the Gyro who had the Aegis, so it didn't even matter if he died. Very, very convincing. Nice drive.